Good morning, and a very warm welcome to you to our YouTube services for St Peter's Stapenhill and St Giles Colwell. It's really good that we can meet together like this, even if it's in our own homes. So let's start our service this morning with a prayer, shall we? Lord, we thank you this morning for the opportunity we have to meet together in our own homes. We pray, Lord, that we may know your presence amongst us. And we ask that you open our hearts and minds to your word, so that we may grow in you. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. It's great to start our time together by looking at a few verses from the Bible to encourage us and to help focus our minds. And I'd just like to read a few verses from Psalm 103. Praise my Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. This psalm was obviously important to Henry Francis Lyell, who was a vicar in the fishing village of Brixham in Devon back in 1834. Why do we know that? Because it was the inspiration that led him to write one of our best known hymns, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. So let's join with all those people through the ages and sing this wonderful hymn to our great redeeming God. Jack Harling is now going to introduce our theme for this morning. So over to you, Jack. Thank you, Jack, for that great little animation. Do you know it takes a long time to put something together like that? So thanks, Jack, it's really appreciated. We're now going to visit the Hodson Walker family on their farm near Caldwell. And Ellie is going to bring us our reading.
The Parable of the Sower. Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered round him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake, where all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. He taught them many things by parables, and in his teachings he said, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell along rocky places, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, but because the soil was shallow, that when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell amongst thorns, so they did not bear grain. Still, other seed fell amongst good soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times." Then Jesus said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." When he was alone, the 12 and others around him asked about the parables. He told them, "The secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to those on the other side, everything is said in parables, so that they may ever be seeing but never perceiving, ever hearing but never understanding, otherwise they might turn and be forgiven." Then Jesus said to them, "Do you understand this parable? How then will you understand any parable? Farmers sow the world. Some people are like the seed along the path, where the world is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes away the word that was sown in them. Others, like the seed sown on rocky places, hear the word and at once receive it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. Still others, like seeds sown amongst thorns, hear the word, but the worries of life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desire for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful. Others, like seeds sown on good soil, hear the word, accept it, and produce a crop, 30, 60, or even 100 times that was sown."
Thank you, Ellie, for reading. That's really appreciated. And also, I must thank Becky and Roger for allowing us to use their field. Here we are, stood in the middle of a wheat field, as you can see all around me. And nothing could be really more appropriate, could it, when we're looking at the parable of the sower. If you've been following us, you'll know that we're doing a series in Mark's Gospel. And we've reached Mark 4 today, which is the parable of the sower. But let's just sort of put it into context by considering what's been going on so far. I always think it's good to look at the start because it provides the whole setting for the book. And Mark 1, verse 1 says this. It says, "The beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ, the Son of God." So we open with a bold statement that this is a beginning. The book does not conclude. Therefore, there is no end. The gospel, in other words, the good news that Jesus is the Son of God and that he came to earth so that he would die for our sins so that we could be forgiven and then be reunited with God. And through that, experience eternal life. That good news of the gospel is ongoing. And this day at the beginning of Mark's gospel was merely the start. Then Mark goes on to prove that Jesus is the Son of God, as we've been seeing, that Jesus has the authority of God. And he does this by describing the miracles and the healing. He lets the actions and teachings of Jesus speak for themselves. And it's through these that he wants us to know that Jesus really is the Son of God. The events he records are the indisputable proof of that. So coming to our passage today, we can see that because of the miracles and healings, unsurprisingly, he has gathered huge crowds around him. You get the impression that this huge crowd was following him most of the time. And we've read, haven't we, in chapter 3, then Jesus entered a house and again a crowd gathered so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. So we can see that in some ways they were becoming a bit of a hindrance. Also, the news of what Christ was doing soon reached the ears of the religious leaders. They start to accuse him of demonic works. And even early on in his ministry here, we read that they've already started to plan how they can get rid of him. And even his own family thought he was out of his mind. So we have massive crowds and strong opposition building. Why do so many reject him? What's going on here? And this is the point we've reached when we come to our passage, and it's what our passage is going to answer. So, Mark 4, 1-20. The passage breaks itself down into three sections, which we will look at in turn. Firstly, in verses 1-9, we have the parable itself. Secondly, in verses 10-12, we're introduced to the concept of outsiders and insiders. And lastly, in verses 13-20, we have the explanation of the difference between the outsiders and the insiders. So firstly then, let's come to that most familiar parable. And I'm sure this must be one of the best known passages of the whole Bible. The parable of the sower. Firstly, let's remind ourselves of what a parable is. It comes from the Greek word parabole. And that's where we get the para from, in parallel. Parabole means placing one thing alongside another for comparison. So it's simply a way to compare one thing with another, which then helps us in our understanding. Jesus didn't invent parables. You'll find them in the Old Testament. And if you want to look at one, have a look at Samuel 2 and verse and chapter 12. Now notice the first word that Jesus said before he starts describing the parable. He says in verse 3, listen. And notice how he ends it in verse 9. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Here it's really saying, look, this is important. Give it your full attention. Listen really hard and think about it. And obviously, as we will see later, something the majority did not do. It's so important for us to listen carefully to what the Word of God is saying to us. And why wouldn't we do that when we realise what Jesus has done for us? So we are to consider it and think about it deeply. And it's also a warning, because if you don't, there will be consequences. So, we have a sower broadcasting his seed. This was something that the crowds would have been very familiar with. It was an everyday event in their rural society. And I'm sure we've all seen the pictures of the farmer with a bag on his shoulder, scattering the seed with his hand. The fields did not have fences or walls around them. They were surrounded with paths, and it was on these that they travelled from one place to the next. We know that the paths were dry and hard, a bit like the ground here, to be honest, and uncultivated. So it's no surprise that the seed did not germinate. Birds love a free meal, so they would be quickly eaten. We then read in verse 5 about the rocky place. Again, no surprise here. The area around the Sea of Galilee is a limestone region, and limestone classically leads to rocky soils. In fact, the rabbis used to say when God put rocks on the earth, he made a mistake and dumped them all on Israel. So the seed germinates, but because the soil is so thin, there are few nutrients stored, and the plant then quickly withers. Now, the crowd would be familiar with this, as they would have been with the plants that were choked with weeds. They did not have chemicals to control weed growth. They had to hand weed to get rid of them, and often it was left to harvest time to avoid damaging the crop. So inevitably, some parts of the field, the crop would be smothered. So there is nothing new here to the listeners. And they also know that on good soil, plants grew and could be harvested. Again, nothing new. But Jesus did throw in a surprise in his story, and that would be a big one. Notice he says in verse 8, it will produce a crop 30, 60 or 100 fold. Let me put that into context. The average wheat yield in the UK in 2019 was 8.5. So nowhere near those numbers of 30, 60 or 100. So that would have made them sit up and think, do you know, I'm sure they were thinking he must have got that wrong. They would know what kind of yields they were getting. So we have a story about sowing with a bit of a strange ending. And I'm sure the majority of the crowd would think, so what? What's that all about? Can't mean much. Let's get back to Jesus healing more people. Let's see the supernatural, the spectacular. Let's get Uncle Harry's hand healed or young Tom's blindness sorted out. So that's the parable. And as we've already discussed, it ends with the instruction to listen or hear. We then move on to our second section in verses 10 to 13, which explains why Jesus spoke in parables. And these are very shocking verses in many ways. You know, they're a complete contrast to that nice little story we might have learnt at Sunday school. So let's just read them again, shall we? When he was alone, the 12 and the others around him asked about the parables. And he told them, the secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you. But to those on the outside, everything is told in a parable, so that they may ever seeing, but never be perceiving, and ever hearing, but never understanding. Otherwise, they might turn and be forgiven. Here, Jesus is quoting from Isaiah 6. God tells Isaiah to go and proclaim a message that stops them from understanding, so that they won't repent, so that they will not be forgiven. He is to preach and preach and preach until Israel goes into exile. He's to preach them out of the land of promise. And he's successful, because exactly what God wants to happen happens through Isaiah's ministry. He wants Isaiah to bring about his judgment over Israel, which had turned its back on God. His words are very powerful, but it's a very gloomy job, isn't it? You can imagine being pretty depressed if you were Isaiah and just being given this job. They were kept in the dark until God's purpose was revealed. So what is Jesus saying here? There are two groups in his explanation. There are those to whom the secret of the kingdom of God has been given. Those are the insiders. And then in verse 11, notice how he describes them, those on the outside, the outsiders. So a parable will divide people into insiders and outsiders. The outsiders had plenty of opportunity to understand what Jesus was talking about. If you think about it, firstly, they had been taught their Old Testament well, so that they would be really versed in the signs of the coming of the Messiah. Also, John the Baptist had clearly proclaimed who Jesus was. And Christ's own teachings were about explaining the kingdom. And the miracles he carried out were primarily in order to confirm that indeed he was the Son of God, sent to announce and be the means by which God's kingdom would come to them. But still they refused to listen. They did not hear. They remained on the outside. And God was going to use the outsiders to ultimately bring his plan about for the redemption of mankind. It was the outsiders who put Jesus on the cross. The key element, though, that distinguishes one from the other, according to our verses, is that the insiders gather around Jesus to find out more. Notice that in verse 10 there. The disciples are no different from anyone else in needing an explanation, But they are different from the outsiders in that they chose to come to Jesus for that explanation. Insiders are not indifferent. They want to know. And Mark tells us that Jesus explains the parables to his disciples privately because they come to him and ask for an explanation. And we also read about that. He does the same thing later on in this chapter, in verse 34. The fact that Jesus does this in private does not mean that he intends to exclude others. Outsiders simply do not regard what he says to be critical enough to bother joining the disciples around Jesus in order to receive that explanation. So what of that explanation? Our third point. How does Jesus explain the difference between the insiders and the outsiders? How does he explain to his disciples why so many in his ministry still remain on the outside? Firstly, in verse 13, he explains it's vital that they understand this parable, and it's about his teaching ministry. And if they are to understand that, they need to know what this parable means. Jesus likens himself to the sower, and notice that he sows everywhere, not just in the places where he thinks the seed might be most productive. Everyone hears. The seed that fell on the path is a warning that Satan is still a danger to those who hear indifferently. There are two types of kingdom in deadly combat for the souls of humans. Satan feasts off the type represented in the story by teachers of the law from Jerusalem, in other words, the chief priests. They hear Jesus immediately and want to destroy him. And we read about that in verse 22 of chapter 3 and also later on in verse 18 of chapter 11. For some listeners, nothing will save them whatever Jesus says or does. They observe his miracles and teaching, and they put it down to black magic or that he is crazy. Satan controls them, not Jesus. The seed in the rocky ground springs up immediately and receives the word joyfully. But the rock does not allow the roots of the plants to sink deep into the nourishing soil. When good times are over and persecution arrives, the plant shrivels. The faith of such people is described in Hosea in chapter 6 and verse 4. He says, like the morning mist, like the early dew that disappears. They fall away when threatened by the slightest challenge to their faith. This type of person might be in church every week. They may have all the outward signs of joy. But when problems arise or their faith is challenged, then they just fall away. The disciples experience this. Jesus warns them at the Last Supper. He says, you will all fall away, Jesus told them. And his prediction is fulfilled when they run for their lives. And you remember when Peter was challenged, he too denied the Lord. The rocky ground serves as a warning that our faith must run deep if we are to survive the trials that life brings. The third ground is not infertile, but weed-ridden, so that the seed suffocates. And Jesus frequently warns in his teaching against things associated with choking thorns, the cares of the world, the delight in riches, the desire for other things. You know, that classic example, the rich ruler in chapter 10, where his material wealth separated from the promise of God's kingdom. This type of person allows the materialism of the world to come between themselves and the good news of the gospel. And the cares of the world, those maybe things like self-image or children or finances or work and health. If we're not careful, these things can completely dominate us to the preclusion of all else. We cannot stop problems, we all have them, and they can overwhelm life. And that's why it says in Philippians in chapter 4, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace that transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ. What a great promise that is to us today, and especially in the troubled times in which we live. Now, the seed that fell on good earth, it doesn't tell us much about, except for the fact that it bears tremendous harvest. But we can assume it was the opposite of the outsiders. In fact, it's describing the insiders, isn't it? The good soil welcomes the word immediately, so that it cannot be snatched away by Satan. The good hearer welcomes it deeply, so it's not withered by persecution. And the good hearer welcomes it exclusively, so that other concerns do not strangle it. And it's fruitful beyond all expectation. It will produce a massive harvest. And if you ever need proof of that, consider this. It's estimated there were only about 600 to 700 Christians at the time of Christ's crucifixion. There are now 2 billion people on earth who profess some sort of Christianity. Now that is one huge increase. So we have looked at one of the best known parables this morning, and see how it explained to the disciples the varied responses of people to our Lord's teaching. We've seen that it divided people into insiders and outsiders. And we've also looked at the reasons why people are outsiders, through the way that they respond when they hear the word. And we've seen how the Lord has used the insiders to spread the good news of his gospel. So what of all this for us? Well, firstly and most obviously, are you an insider or an outsider? Do you really know the truth of the gospel of Christ in your lives? Do you really know that Christ died for your sins, and that through the cross you can be forgiven and experience the love, joy, and peace that only Christ can bring? And with that comes also the promise of an eternal future with him. Now notice one thing about all the outsiders, the seed on the path, the rocky places and the thorns. They all ended up dead. The warning is this: there is a serious consequence for remaining on the outside. It is literally life and death. For those of us who know the love of the Lord, there is a warning. We must not become the seed that fails. Unfortunately, it's not all up to us. For as we've already seen, there is help. We are to bring our troubles to the Lord and trust in him to provide. All you have to do, the distinguishing difference in the parable, is to ask, to come to our Lord, to bring our ignorance. We are to bring ourselves as empty vessels, and he will fill us with his understanding, his love, and his power. He will fill us to an extent that we would never have dreamt possible if we just ask. And lastly, we are each called to be sowers of the world, to let people know the good news of the gospel. Some of us will feel confident to share the gospel with those around us. To others, it might be that they simply invite friends and family to come and join them in either their lounges to look at our YouTube services, or to bring them along to our evening service. We are to sow. It is God who will reap. And we should not be too discouraged as a church if people fall by the wayside. From this parable, we can see that that is what happens. But neither should we stop sowing, for we will never know when that seed which yields 100-fold will come along. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the light of your gospel. May we live in that light, and through your Spirit, may you use us to bring others to that light. For we ask it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. We now come to our time of confession. The Bible teaches us that we have all sinned. We have all fallen short of the standards that God expects of us. And that's a problem because it separates us from God. It breaks our relationship with Him. But the Bible also tells us that we can restore that relationship. And because of what Jesus did on the cross for us, all we have to do is to say sorry to God and to ask for forgiveness. So let's just do that as we say the words that will appear on your screen. We say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, although we are sinners, you made us your sons and daughters when your Son took our sin on the cross. Yet we still sin against you, never loving you as we should, often doing what you hate. Have mercy on us, dear Father, though you have every right to be angry. Show us our sin. Lead us back from where we have gone astray, and renew our longing to serve you, forgiven, forever, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, our Heavenly Father, has promised to forgive all those who sincerely turn to Him. He has mercy on each one of us and delivers us from our sins and strengthens us for His service through Jesus. Amen. Let's continue now by saying the Lord's Prayer together. And after that, Liz will lead us in our prayers of intercessions. So we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Let us put ourselves into the hands of the Lord, and pray that God will bless us and our families during these wonderful months of summer. May we all help to make our home a place of relaxation, joy, love, peace, and safety. Loving God, Creator of all times and places, we thank you for the gift of summertime, the days of light, warmth, and leisure. Thank you for the beauty that surrounds us everywhere we look. The multicoloured flowers, the deep blue of the sky, the tranquil surface of lakes, the laughter of children at play, people strolling in the park, families gathered around picnic tables, and the increased time we now have as the lockdown eases to spend with family and friends. As we open our eyes and ears to the landscape of nature and people, open our hearts to receive all as a gift, and warm our souls with the awareness of your presence. Let all the gifts we enjoy this summer deepen our awareness of your love, so that we may share this with others and enjoy a summertime of recreation. Thank you for your word. We pray that as we see the grain fields growing, we may know the truth of the gospel of Christ in our lives. Lord, we praise you and thank you that Christ died for our sins, and that through his death on the cross, we can be forgiven and receive the promise of eternal life with you. Please help us to bring our concerns to you and trust in you. By the power of your Spirit, please fill us with your understanding, love, and power. Please help us to be sowers of your word, so that people may hear the good news of your gospel. We read in Matthew chapter 9, verse 37, that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. We ask that you will strengthen and guide us so that we may be fruitful workers in your harvest field. We thank you for all those who volunteer their services in the many different roles at St. Peter's and St. Giles. We ask that, as we start to meet together once again, we will be able to support one another safely and be a welcoming church family. We are aware, Lord, of an increase in COVID-19 cases in areas of Burton. We pray, Lord, that your love would reach out to those affected. Please strengthen the medical and support staff in the town, and particularly at Queen's Hospital. Please keep them safe and give them wisdom and compassion. We pray, Lord, for our Prime Minister, the government, and all in authority, that they may make wise decisions in all areas of our national life. We thank you that we are part of your worldwide family and all can trust in you. So now, as we finish our prayers this morning, we join with the Church of South India as we pray. God our Father, by whose mercy the world turns safely into darkness and returns again to light, we place in your hands our unfinished tasks, our unsolved problems, and our unfulfilled hopes, knowing that only what you bless will prosper. To your love and protection, we commit each other and all those we love, knowing that you alone are our sure defender. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Liz. Our last song is a new one. Unlike our opening hymn, which was written nearly 200 years ago, this song was written earlier this year. It is Christ Our Hope in Life and Death, and hopefully you've had a chance to listen to it. And it reminds us that in these times where we have very restricted lives due to the coronavirus, there's really only one thing we need, and that is the good news of the gospel. And this song reminds us of that, of God's love for each one of us, a love which calms our fears and a love which brings us through death into an eternal future with our Lord and Saviour. And what is our response to be for this, to this amazing gospel? Well, the song puts it this way. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. Soul. God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith
Lord, we thank you for our time together this morning. And as we go into the coming week, may we put our trust completely in you and your word and be the good soil you want us to be. May we be fruitful and look for opportunities to tell others about the good news of your gospel. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's simply close by saying the grace together, shall we? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen. This ends our YouTube service for this morning, but we do have a Zoom coffee and chat session coming up. So we're looking forward to meeting you there. And if you haven't got the codes for that, and if you want to join us next week, simply get in touch with the church office. And just a quick reminder, we are having a service in church this evening at 6:30. It'll be a spoken word service, but you'd be very welcome to join us there. Thank you.